So in the management of neuroendocrine tumors, which are a rare tumor, there are multiple different treatment options that exist for patients. Surgery is among those options. The important thing is that patients with neuroendocrine tumors get managed by a multidisciplinary team who can identify the best next step for their specific tumor type. And I think with all of the new therapies that we have available for patients, just thinking with a team, a group of people who manage neuroendocrine tumors, it's a very interesting space to work in. And so I enjoy treating patients with neuroendocrine tumors and doing research, evaluating how we can make progress in treating these patients.
Surgery, I think, is an option for most NET patients. For example, most patients should have their primary tumor found and removed, in my opinion, and it provides multiple benefits in terms of preventing bowel obstruction, reducing pain, reducing symptoms, and there's the potential survival benefit.
Identifying the primary tumor is of importance because it may determine ultimately what treatments you might be eligible for. So in the setting of small bowel neuroendocrine tumors, typically surgery is the first line approach, even in the setting of metastatic disease to the liver, primarily because we don't have many additional options that we know are of tremendous benefit. Small bowel neuroendocrine tumors tend to be generally fairly slow growing and well differentiated. And in that setting, we're able to remove, ideally, the primary site, the lymph nodes to which the tumor may or may not have metastasized to, and frequently perform cytoreductive or debulking surgery to remove tumors in the liver or in the peritoneum should we see it. The thought is that if we're able to do that successfully, this can certainly prolong your survival. And can reduce the additional types of therapies that you may need down the line. Really knowing the type of tumor that you have or where this all started is important in terms of determining the next best step in your case.
I got interested in neuroendocrine tumors because my father died from one. When I was 8 years old, we moved from Scotland to America. And when you immigrate, you have to get a chest x-ray to exclude tuberculosis. And we found that half of his chest was occupied with a tumor that at first we were told was an atypical form of lung cancer. It actually turns out to have been a thymic carcinoid. So for a long time growing up, I knew I wanted to go into medicine. I knew I wanted to go into oncology. And these rare tumors spoke to me because I saw through no fault of their own, you know, my father's oncologist had to take care of every type of cancer. He was not an expert in neuroendocrine disease. And I saw how much benefit my dad got when he was able to connect with a subspecialist. And these days in oncology, it is extremely difficult to have both breadth and depth. So I was diagnosed my very first week of oncology training. I woke up the day I was to start my fellowship and I had horrible abdominal pain. And I went into the ER and it was actually a high calcium level. And that's when everything clicked for me because my father had had that too. And there are very few conditions in medicine that would cause consecutive generations to have high calcium. And one of them is the tumor syndrome MEN1, or multiple endocrine neoplasia type 1. So I actually diagnosed myself with that essentially day one of my training. I went to the internist I'd been assigned, who thought I was a hypochondriac, because here I am, you know, just starting my cancer training and convinced myself I've got this rare disease. But everything clicked into focus. It was really a eureka moment because it explained what had happened to my dad. And then I'm unfortunately the perfect example of autosomal dominant inheritance, meaning each one of my children has a 50-50 chance of inheriting this for me. And my daughter, who's 12, is healthy and doesn't have it. My son, who's 9, does. But it is hard to see, not just a rare illness, but a rare illness that is kind of passed down from generation to generation. And presumably until some form of gene editing, this is something that's gonna affect me my entire life and my son as well. But that's also what's motivating. In my own case, because I have a hereditary mutation, I was able to watch my own pancreas. And when one of the tumors became threatening in the head of the pancreas, I was able to have it removed.
If you can find the primary tumor and remove it, it appears to result in better survival rates than patients who have their primary tumors left in. I think one thing people don't understand is how many patients are actually eligible for liver surgery. Most surgeons that are even oncologists that are looking at a patient saying, gee, could this patient potentially be a surgical candidate, They look at a liver, and unless they can see one tumor in the right lobe that can be removed with by removing the right half of the liver, or one tumor in the left lobe, or a couple tumors in the left lobe that can be removed by removing the left lobe of the liver, they just think they're not candidates. And the vast majority of neuroendocrine patients have multiple tumors in both lobes of the liver at diagnosis. The reason that you have to remove lobes in other kinds of cancers is because those tumors act like dandelions within the liver. There's a main tumor, but it spreads out with tentacles that are extending microscopically. And if you don't get a wide margin around those, you cut across them and leave cancer behind, and the tumor recurs quite quickly. And that is not the case with neuroendocrine tumors. They land in the liver and they are expansile, not invading, meaning they expand like a sphere and push the liver out of the way, which means we can actually just enucleate them, roll them out of the liver without removing a lot of liver. So in the vast majority of liver operations I do, I don't remove a lobe of the liver or even much normal liver. Rather, we pop the tumors out of the liver.
There's different ways we can approach patients surgically. So depending again on the tumor type and the surgery that's required, you may opt to perform a procedure either open, meaning with an incision, laparoscopically, which means with small incisions and cameras, which in the setting, for example, of small bowel neuroendocrine tumors is accompanied by a small open incision because we frequently want to examine the entire small intestine to make sure that there's not additional tumors outside of the one that we know we're going for, or the lymph nodes. And then there's also another type of minimally invasive surgery known as robotic surgery that's becoming more prevalent. We have become more aggressive in terms of surgical management of patients, despite having better therapies. But that's also because we're seeing, improvements in survival and response, and sometimes even in patients who may initially not be eligible for surgery, they may have disease that's refractory to certain types of treatments, and so surgery fits in there. And occasionally we're seeing patients who the first order of business is really to provide them with surgery, because frequently surgery can be, to some degree, curative in that subset of patients.
So the type of surgery for neuroendocrine tumor is really determined by where you are in the body. And I think it's a common misconception that all neuroendocrine tumors are in the gut. Some of them, of course, are in the actual small bowel. Others are in the adjacent pancreas. Still others can occur in the lungs. In women, they can occur on the ovaries. So really, the type of surgery you're going to get is determined by which body cavity, if you will, is affected. And I really think there is a lot to be said for subspecialty surgeons. So I was very lucky here when I had my Whipple surgery. I was literally working with a man, and I knew how good he was. I knew his operative outcomes. And for most surgical series, you'll find a cutoff of somewhere around 10 cases a year, meaning that it's like Malcolm Gladwell's 10,000 hours theory. If you're not doing something often, it's very difficult to do it well. And so for surgeons who are performing, say, the Whipple procedure like I had, that's an enormously complex operation. My surgery took 6.5 hours. And going back, so they actually were very gracious and let me take pictures, or have our media team take pictures during the operation, which were then live tweeted. So I can go back and see step by step just how complicated it was. And by picking a surgeon who has a high caseload, high volume, I felt very reassured. And indeed, I've been very, very fortunate with my health. So the Whipple surgery, that's an eponym for Dr. Whipple, the surgeon who basically pioneered this technique. So what I lost in the surgery is I lost the head of my pancreas, I lost this portion of my small intestine, which is called the duodenal sweep, and I lost my gallbladder and part of my bile duct. And this all had to be reconnected. So this is a very, very difficult place to get to. It's actually much closer to your back than it is to your front. So they spent hours in the operating room just getting here, let alone doing that massive reconstruction.
Surgery can be used initially at the time of diagnosis to manage you, and it may be used again in the future depending on what your particular tumor is doing. So if you have surgery once, it does not mean that you won't be a candidate in the future or that you won't require it in the future, and I think that's across the line for all different types of neuroendocrine tumors.
When I look at the small bowel neuroendocrine patients, certainly we'll operate on their primary, and in the vast majority of patients, we will debulk the liver at the same time if we can. It turned out that progression of the liver in small bowel neuroendocrine tumor patients seemed to be age dependent. The younger the patient was, the sooner they got liver tumors again. And the older the patient was, the longer it was until they got more liver tumors. In fact, with 8 years of follow-up, I haven't found the average time till a person over age 50 gets more liver tumors again. We still haven't reached that. My data show that 1/3 of my small bowel patients have more than one operation to debulk their liver. And some patients have 3, and occasionally some patients even have 4 to keep, you know, resetting the clock or kicking the can down the street. Pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors appear to be a bit more aggressive. They recur faster. It is not age dependent. The only thing I've found that predicts getting more liver disease if you have a pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor spread to the liver is having any tumor bigger than 5 centimeters or about 2.5 inches. And yes, we will operate on those patients again too. And the time interval between operations is shorter for them.
So surgery is just one tool in the toolbox. And thankfully these days we see surgeons collaborating with medical oncologists, with radiation oncologists, and with interventional radiologists. And again, the perfect example is the liver. The liver has a bilobed shape, so it has basically 2 halves. And what that allows you to do is something very smart, is that you can block off deliberately the blood supply to one half and see the other half grow, so that that gives you more reserve. So the classic example of a surgeon teaming up with an interventional radiologist is something called portal vein embolization, which again allows this hypertrophy, this growth to happen. You can also target the hepatic arteries that selectively feed the neuroendocrine tumors in the liver. So I often see interventional radiologists and surgeons working together really to make the liver the best it can be both before and after surgery.
Surgery is frequently an option for patients, even in the setting of widespread disease, but there are some scenarios in which surgery may not be a good option. Frequently, those are patients who have significant comorbidities, meaning you're very sick from other things, and surgery would be a tremendous strain on your body, and you may just not be healthy enough to tolerate that type of intervention. There are a subset of patients with carcinoid heart disease, for example, that present very late in their management, and they're just not eligible for certain surgical procedures or other procedures. In the setting of very widespread metastatic disease, for example, if you have disease to the bone, it's widespread to the liver, there's, you know, no ability to do anything that would be beneficial to you, then surgery may not be an option. But outside of those settings, typically surgery is something we consider at each step in managing our neuroendocrine patients.
So when you're considering someone's surgical candidacy, and frankly, we do this calculus in all oncology, there's this notion of something called performance status. And what that means is we try to quantify, and this is going to sound strange at first, how fit someone is, how fit they are to endure treatment. And it's a double-edged sword, because oftentimes the reason someone might be medically unfit is the underlying disease. So it seems almost cruel, like double jeopardy, to deprive them of something. So that is, I know it's a strange answer, but that's one way we assess fitness for surgery.
Net surgeries vary tremendously in their duration. My average time to find a primary tumor has been measured. It's 3 minutes, and then it may take me, 20, 30 minutes to do a bowel resection after that. But the liver debulking can be something that requires commitment of time until we achieve that 70, 80, 90, whatever the highest debulking threshold that we can achieve in them. And so they can sometimes go 12 and 18 hours.
I see a lot of patients with metastatic neuroendocrine tumors, both from pancreatic primaries and small bowel primaries. And frequently patients have been seen by physicians who were not specialists in neuroendocrine tumors. And when they present, they frequently ask, well, I've been told that surgery is not an option for my liver disease. The reality is surgery is very frequently an option for metastatic liver tumors. Again, it depends on the primary tumor type. So is it coming from your pancreas? Is it coming from your lung? Is it coming from your small intestine? And what other therapies are you eligible for? For surgery specifically, what we look for in determining if a patient is eligible for liver cytoreductive surgery, meaning to decrease the tumor burden in your liver, we want to be fairly confident that if we're operating on you, that we're able to get rid of about 70% of the disease. Now, that doesn't mean that we have to cut out 70% of the disease. It means that we can also treat that disease with different ablative techniques, whereby we introduce essentially heat, microwavable heat, to the tumors directly so as to kill the tumors and spare the surrounding healthy liver. And that's frequently combined with actual surgery to remove potentially the bulk of the tumors.
The one thing I will say about the liver, it is remarkably regenerative. It is really the only organ I know of that you can cut and watch regrow. And so there are these really amazing techniques where you can block off the blood flow to one side of the liver to force the other side to hypertrophy before you do surgery. And that raises your functional capacity before you go in for a big operation. The other thing I'll point out, sort of a bridge between medical oncology and surgical oncology, is interventional radiology. So the other thing we can take advantage of is the liver and liver metastases have a distinct blood supply where you can selectively pick off the hepatic artery and allow the portal vein to continue providing blood to the normal liver. So neuroendocrine tumors are extremely vascular, and if you think about it, the liver is just one big filter for blood. So when they get there, I almost envision them having these little sort of tentacles or tendrils, and those are very, very vulnerable to being embolized. So short of an operation, you can actually do a procedure. Often they'll access these vessels through the groin, just like if you were doing a heart catheterization, but they take a turn and go into the liver, and they can pick off pretty selectively the neuroendocrine tumor blood flow.
So I think it's an exciting time to work in the arena of neuroendocrine cancer. As a surgeon, what's most interesting to us is certainly the, you know, the advent of personalized medicine, determining the best treatment options at the right time, the utility of PRT and systemic therapies, including, you know, potential new targeted therapies that may become available, and really determining where should we start. Is surgery the next best thing? Is that the first thing we should be doing? Is it the last thing we should be doing? And where does that fit? So I think just from a treatment management perspective, it's an exciting time to see where surgery fits in.
So where I see surgery going in the next decade or so, and again, this is more as a patient even than as an oncologist, is getting less and less invasive. It is my desperate hope that my son, in his lifetime, will not require the Whipple operation that I've been through. So where I think things are going is getting, again, less invasive, more targeted. So there are even some gastroenterologists, some complex endoscopists, who can put, for instance, an ultrasound probe down near the pancreas and use that to deliver treatments into the pancreas rather than cutting someone open from stem to stern. So that's where I think we're going.
For patients who have neuroendocrine tumors, the thing that I would stress most significantly is try to find a team of individuals who treat neuroendocrine tumors. There are specifics both for surgeons and, you know, medical oncologists and interventional radiologists that a team who's not comfortable dealing with neuroendocrine patients may not be aware of. You may have been told that you're ineligible for surgery or other treatment options. And so I think it's important for patients to find surgeons who specialize in neuroendocrine tumors and have a consultation. And that's the one thing that I would probably stress.